Welcome back, YouTube. So it is still Thursday, December 29th, 2022, for at least a couple more days, 9:55 a.m. And I wasn't going to shoot any more video today, at least not until after I've gone to sleep and woke up, and at which point it'll be functionally another day for me. So just for the record, this is not an early morning, this is a late night. Did you hear that? That's what I wanted to share with y'all. I've mentioned several times in my vlog, but it's been a while since I've mentioned it. When I was much younger, I used to work in broadcasting. I was a professional broadcaster, primarily what people would refer to as a radio DJ, although in the business, it would generally be referred to as an air talent. And back then, I was all about live radio and doing a live radio show where I was playing records or playing CDs or, more often than not, playing songs pre-recorded on carts and talking in between them and just kind of doing my thing and you know, reading the weather and sometimes giving local news or whatever and then playing the commercials, all of that. And automated radio was very much a thing then, but was quickly becoming more and more of a thing, especially in small markets. One of the main reasons I stopped doing radio was just the amount of available jobs just really disappeared, at least the kind of jobs I wanted, as more and more stations became automated. So anyway, the station that's playing on my radio right now, which is 94.9 FM, and they're also on another frequency, I think it's 95.1 FM, doesn't make a difference, they're both doing exactly the same thing. It's a station that refers to themselves as the Wow Factor, and as far as everything I've listened to on it, I'm imagining it's fully automated. I just hear ads, what sound like canned pre-recorded liners, and music. It's not the main station I listen to, but it's one that I keep on a preset since my CD player hasn't worked in like a year and a half. And because they play a lot of music that I like. It's mostly old stuff, late 60s, 70s, early 80s, sometimes older than that. I mean, like right now they're playing Dead Air. Now they're playing the Beatles, Come Together, late 60s. And as you notice, it keeps pausing and then starting back up again, and pausing, starting back up again. And this has been going on for a while. Like, I just got finished up at the bank, and on the way to the bank, they played two songs that I really, really liked. And it was doing this in the whole song, which is driving me nuts. Like, it played 25 or 64 by Chicago. Not such a huge fan of, like, Peter Cetera mid to late 80s era Chicago, but God, I love 1970s Chicago. And I forget what the song was they played after that. Oh no, that was the second song they played. The one that I was scanning across and stopped on was The Letter by the Box Tops, which is one of those oldies that I also absolutely love. But so this has been going on for a while. I want to say at least 15, 20 minutes where the song plays. And then it just cuts out, pauses for a while, getting ready for it to do it again. There we go. We got some dead air. And then seems to start back up at exactly where it left off at.
A radio station called the Wow Factor has a lot to love.
There's a liner playing through automation.
We try to wow you every single day. The Wow Factor.
Which I'm sure in 2022, I mean, I worked briefly at a station here in Phoenix in 1995, and at that point in time, everything was played from a computer, and it was automated. So I'm sure everything's playing from computer files. I don't know why it's doing what it's doing, and it just goes to show that since it's automated, nobody at the radio station is aware that this is going on. And because there's no live air talent, DJ, if there's nobody actively running the station and listening to the station as it's running, what happens if something goes wrong? Yeah, it's a wow factor today. Like, wow, how is nobody noticing this? But generally speaking, like, one company could only own one AM station and one FM station. I forget what year that was eliminated. I want to say it was in the 1990s. Probably mid to early 1990s. It was definitely after I got out of radio, though. And I wanted to turn left there. Whoops. Anyway, what it resulted in is very large mega corporations buying up damn near every radio station in the United States. And a whole lot more automation, which granted can give some nice listening options when it works, but also can result in situations like what's going on now, where you've got an unattended broadcast that's being dysfunctional. Although it seems like they might have fixed it. It hasn't paused in a moment. I haven't noticed a pause in the Neil Diamond. Oh, nope, it's still messed up. Ooh, look forward, balls. So it definitely resulted in a whole lot more stations just running automation. And a lot less diversity in radio programming, where you have these big, big, big stations that are running functionally the same thing in every different market, and basically three corporations that own almost every radio station in America. It's a big part of why I quit pursuing a career in radio broadcasting. The other part was I was just doing so much better as a cab driver, but that's a separate tragedy. Anyway, so I have no idea, like, what... Obviously, this is not the flagship station of whatever group of stations this is part of now. I don't know what its sister stations are. You know, it used to be if you had a sister station in building, and you usually did, it was, if you were an AM station, the sister station was an FM, or vice versa. And that's how most stations I worked at were, like, as, you know, I was younger. I mean, the first one I worked at was KWIV, which was 1470 AM in Douglas, Wyoming. And our FM sister station was, I think it was 99.3 KATH FM. Next station I worked at was actually just an AM, did not have a sister station. It was a KVOC in Casper. And then, yeah, that failed miserably. The next station I worked at, that was kind of a failure of me as well. I was in and out of that building so quick. I remember that the FM station was KMOR. I believe they had an AM sister station, but damned if I can remember what it was. Oh, I don't recall that I had anything to do with the AM there. And granted, I'm getting way off track here, but the first one that I worked at, KWIV, with very little exception, KWIV was live, and KATH was automated. Now, it was a whole different type of automation than what we have today. Like, nowadays, you'll have a computer that's just got functionally a playlist and software that's just playing computer files. Because what do most people listen to when they listen to music nowadays? Computer files. If you're streaming, you're listening to computer files. Back in that day, playing music from computer files, you know, I'm talking like mid-1980s, 1986, 1987. Playing music from computer files wasn't really an option, at least not one that I know existed then. Now, granted, there was a computer, but the computer basically operated a bunch of physical tape machines. Yeah, still going on. It's been going on for a while. I mean, it should have been probably looking at over a half hour of this problem going on, and God knows how long it was on messing up like this before I noticed it. Anyway, the automation was on KATH. Nobody was listening to KATH in the building, generally speaking. If the computer automation realized something went wrong, it would make an alarm to get your attention while you're running your stuff live. And I think it flashed a light in the control room for KWIV as well. There was also what was called a dead air sensor. And if there was any more than, I want to say 5 seconds, might have been 2 seconds, but I'm thinking it was 5 seconds of dead air, then it would make a louder alarm and again flash a light to let you know that as soon as you finished whatever you were doing live on KWIV, that you needed to go figure out where the automation for KATH sidetracked. But you know, at least I was a live person watching for that. Like, apparently nobody's even watching for this or whatever flaw they're having on the wow factor right now. Like, it's not even notifying anybody. Yeah, this is sad broadcasting. This is really, really, really bad. Anyway, I'm super curious, like, what the main, like, what the popular stations are that are in the same building. And I honestly have no idea, but I'm heading into the Cox store right now to pay my internet for the month. I'm a little bit late doing it. Hopefully I can talk them out of charging me a late fee, since it was a holiday when my stuff was due, and they probably weren't even open. I'm sure they've been open, you know, since Boxing Day, but... the customer service at Cox is usually pretty good. I've got high hopes they're gonna forgive my late fee. But anyway, I'm going to leave it on the wow factor. So when I get back, I'm super curious if this is still going to be going on, and I want to document this. And when I get home, or if I'm having to wait in line here to make my payment at Cox, which I highly doubt, I'm going to find out who exactly it is that owns the wow factor and what building their broadcast is originating out of. Because I'm sure it's in a building with some more mainstream radio stations here in Phoenix. And I always say I'm going to send these emails, and I never do, but I think I really want to get on emailing them about this. And who knows? Maybe it'll result in me making a connection that somehow gets me back into broadcasting. Am I thinking about leaving Amazon? No, not in the slightest. God, I just got a major step up in my job / career at Amazon. And I'm actually, oh God, I love this song. I love the band Bread. David Gates, such a great vocalist and songwriter. It's got good solo stuff, just nobody's ever really listened to it. It's never been successful, but I've got a couple of his solo albums and I love them. I always think about broadcasting. I do. I would love to get back into it sometime. But I'm so out of the loop. Like, if I was to put together a resume for broadcasting, I'm sure it would just be completely ignored. So, but maybe a note about, hey, are you aware this is going on with your signal? Might get noticed. So, maybe, just maybe. Anyway, going in to pay my bill. Thanks for coming with me on the drive and enjoying this dysfunctional bit of Phoenix broadcasting.
I'm back. Yeah, I didn't even realize I parked on the wrong side of that driveway from the Cox store, which is fine. I don't mind walking to it. It's actually pretty nice out right now. It's a little chilly. It's a little wet, but the rain has stopped, and it just feels comfortably cool. It's Phoenix winter. I like Phoenix winter. Where did I park? I parked over there. Yeah, it's probably a little bit less annoying to drive out of here than drive where the Cox store is actually located at anyway. I don't know if I've ever really done a video about this particular shopping center. I know I've come into this area before, mostly going to the Cox store and when I was going through my whole 9 months of no car.
Well, that was brilliant. I just managed to kill the battery on my iPhone. I wasn't even paying attention to the battery level. Whoops. So I was talking about this mall that I'm next to, and the Cox store where I just paid my internet bill. It's not located in the mall. It's actually located in a what would be considered a pad, like adjacent to the mall. And there's not much. This is what's called the Camelback Colonnade Shopping Center. Used to be called the Colonnade Mall, and there's really not much left of the original inside mall. Now, back in the 80s, this used to be like a more traditional mall with kind of an inside and all the stuff you'd find in a typical mall
you know, food court and arcade and department store anchors and what have you. And I want to say in the early 2000s, although it might have actually been in the 90s, the bulk majority of this mall got bulldozed and very little of the original mall still remains, and there's not much for a mall interior anymore. It almost kind of feels weird calling it a mall, but it's not exactly a power center. It's definitely more than a strip mall. And there still is a bit of the interior mall left. I wasn't trying to handle so many errands and then get a decent night's or decent day's sleep. I'd hop out and show you what actually exists of the mall. I feel like I might have included that in my vlog once upon a time, but I don't know. I can't remember. But yeah, the only mall entrance is right here on the left. I don't think it's possible to actually walk through the mall anymore. And there's really not much to it. And pretty much the only thing is this opening that goes down underground. I think there's an escalator, stairs, and an elevator. It takes you to Last Chance Outlet, which is the clearance outlet for... oh my gosh, I forget the name of the major clothing department store. Nordstrom's, I want to say. Anyway, I bought clothes there before. I like buying clothes there, although the last few times I went there, it was so chaotically busy that it didn't make for a pleasant shopping experience. All right, that guy's trying to figure out what lane he needs to be in. And the wow factor is still messing up. I forget what time it was that... But I've already had time to listen to a couple songs on it, go to the bank, handle my banking, drive all the way here to the Colonnade, walk over to the Cox store, handle my business to Cox. And I was there way longer than I needed because I was looking at some wireless microphones. This to me is wild that a station can be malfunctioning like this for this long. Really is. Oh, by the way, shooting video on the Obama phone because the iPhone's dead. But hey, at least I've got an iPhone cable with me, and it's up to 3% now, so that's a good thing. What other errands I still need to do? I did end up, by the way, going to the girlfriend's place. That was all right. I didn't get to indulge in any bedroom fun, but she's really not feeling good. Got there later than she was expecting me, which was pretty deliberate. But yeah, when she came to the door, she's like, "What time is it?" And then when I told her, and it was like 7:30-ish, I was like, "Oh crap! I need to go to some kind of doctor's appointment." Asked if I'd drive her there, so I figured, why the hell not? So that was nice. We got a little bit of quality time riding together in my vehicle, which I find a lot more pleasant than riding her vehicle. And in spite of the fact that I've got way too much recycling on the passenger side floor. Oh, and amusingly enough, she gave me a big bag of her recycling, which is, it doesn't seem that long ago that she was frustrated because I had taken recycling out of my place that she had bagged up, and she felt that I didn't give her money she should have got from that. like, do you really think there's profit involved in recycling anymore? Really? Because, no. Unless you got a bag full of copper. No, it's mostly Type 1 bottles. I don't know. I'm just, you know, I do it just because it feels like it's the right thing to do. And I'm hoping least I want to do what I can to keep supporting brake gear recycling. And not gonna lie, the last time that I did get $60 for my recycling, which is like nothing for the amount of time I put into crushing it, bagging it, and sorting it, it was nice to have $60 in my pocket. Stevie Nicks on the radio. Radio's still cutting out. They took care of me the moment I walked into the building at Cox, so I didn't have any chance to look up where the Wow Factor, where their broadcasts originate from. So that's still a mystery to me. The microphones I looked at look pretty neat, but clearly they're targeted towards just home use, but not even home karaoke use. I don't know, it's kind of weird to me. Like, when I buy microphones, there's certain information I need to see on the packaging, particularly like what inputs and outputs, what frequencies the mics are on, that sort of thing. And it said UHF, but it didn't specify which UHF bands it was in, or which frequencies it was at. The picture of the mics would indicate that I could probably change the frequencies. So, like some microphones that I've owned in the past, most particularly my GTDs, also my old Audio Technica, which still kind of works, but it's really seen better days. Assignable frequencies. So if it goes on one frequency and I'm having crosstalk or interference issues, I can pop it to a different one. It looks like it has that, although that wasn't listed as a feature on the box, just looking at the image of the display. And there goes an asshole flying and passing him, right? Lovely. A little more dead air brought to you by the Wow Factor. Yeah, like, that's a pretty important feature, not listed on the box. And there was no mention whatsoever on the packaging of what sort of power supply it runs off of and what kind of output. The receiver looks like a little tiny thing, probably inadequate for what I do. But I've used some mics in the past before that looked like they might have been inadequate, and after looking over the receiver, I was like, yeah, I can adapt to make that work. But this was a sealed box item, and they don't have a display item that I can actually look at. And the best that she could offer me was, you can take a picture of the packaging and look it up online. Yeah, I'm sure once I look it up online, I can get it for considerably less by buying it at Amazon. But thanks for playing.
Tell your friends and associates.
Anyway, did I say the brand name? It's JBL. I still consider JBL to be a very reputable brand. And although I've never owned a JBL mic, and they're more known for speakers than mics and headphones, I would expect a decent quality microphone from JBL. And why would I be talking about buying microphones now when I just like quit my full-time karaoke gig, or full-time my regular weekly karaoke gig? Because I really need better microphones. That's the bottom line. The big house party I did a week and a half ago over in downtown Scottsdale, or North Scottsdale. It didn't sound bad at all. But I was not happy with the sound quality, and it wasn't the sound quality of my speakers or my music, but specifically the sound quality coming out of my mics. I'm down to two working mics, and both of them are, the more I like the song, the more the song cutting out is annoying to me. Not a big Ricky Nelson fan, but I love this song. I haven't heard this in a while.
If you're ever in Alaska, stop and sing me like you've been Eskimo. Oh, my sweet Fraulein down in Berlin town makes my heart.
I'm gonna get all into it, and it's gonna cut out again. I know it's going to. China. Told ya. I really gotta look out. I'm not changing the station until they resolve this problem. I'm curious how long this shit's gonna go on.
Remember the night when we walked in the sand of
Yeah, so anyway, I'm not actively looking for any more parties. I don't have anything on the horizon with my karaoke, but I'm by no means done. Hell, I still got a good portion of my system in the car right now. Nothing of any real value, don't get any ideas. But yeah. Yeah, it'd certainly be better for me to get some nice microphone. One, maybe two nice microphones to supplement what I have before I have a gig on the horizon. So when I'm doing it, I'm not doing it as a rush to me and getting something that really doesn't suit my needs as well, and, or isn't as good of a price that I like to get. But yeah, two JBL UHF mics with switchable frequencies for $100 seems great, and I can't help but think if that's the price of the Cox store, then there's a much better price to be found online. But if I could have opened it up and looked at that receiver and established that it has what I need, I would have bought it just now. Three medians at that intersection has panhandlers on them. That's freaking fabulous. I'm so tired of panhandlers. Anyway, at this point, I have really nothing of relevance to say. I'm just kind of letting video roll to document the broadcast dysfunction of the wow factor. 95.1 FM and 94.9 FM. I dig how they've got two frequencies completely adjacent to each other. It'd be kind of neat if all simulcast repeater stations that use multiple frequencies to cover a large metropolis type area had their frequencies like right next to each other like that. And I know there's other stations that are like that in Phoenix, but most of them like I might have one preset. Yeah, y'all ain't getting two presets from me. And the wow factor doesn't have two presets for me, but I just know that when the one top is off, it's just nudge it to the next frequency. Anyway, I still got some errands to run, so I'm gonna definitely add more to this. Right now, popping in home, need to feed the. Oh my goodness, these potholes are bad now. Yikes. Oh, damn. Yeah. Need to feed the kitties and handle a couple things inside, but I'll be back with more of this very soon, and see if this automated station that doesn't monitor their own signal has managed to fix their issue.
So, yeah, I'm back. It's still Thursday, December 29th, 11:13 a.m., and the wow factor. Oh, they're playing commercials. I wonder if their commercials are cutting out. Because that's super problematic. People pay for those, yeah.
On Sunday, January 1st, from 11 a.m. to 3 p.m., five players every hour will win $2,203. That's 25 winners and over $50,000 cash. Expect more at Desert Diamond Casino West Valley at Loop 101 in Northern and DVC.
Oh, I'm going the wrong damn direction.
Living trust is the biggest holiday gift you can give to the people you care about. In the spirit of giving this holiday.
Looks like it put the extra pause that they've been putting in, but it looks like it put it in between the ads.
Over 35,000 families.
Sounds like it's been between the ads, I should say.
If you don't have a living trust when you pass away, it could cost your estate tens of thousands of dollars in legal fees if all of your assets get tied up in Arizona probate court.
Don't want assets
people you love, who will be grieving when you're gone, could end up waiting a year.
Off on your living trust if you're 60
or over. Oh, that advertiser didn't get their money's worth.
896-9588 by December 31st to schedule a free consultation. That's 480-896-9588. 480-896-9588.
At Chevy, the holidays mean going places and doing the things you love to do with friends and family. To make new memories on the trails in a Silverado 1500.
All right, there's two advertisements getting cut off and not broadcast like this.
And to take the family new places in the Chevy Equinox. Chevy makes it easier to make the most of your time with the people who matter most.
And it's,
head into your local Chevy dealer first to find your red tag.
Makes it a lot easier to hear it's not a pause. It's just an extended period of getting cut out.
Get $500 red tag bonus cash on select popular 2022 and 2023 Chevy models when you find your tag. Visit ChevyRedTag.com for more details. See your Valley Chevy dealers. Available toward the purchase or lease of all 2022, 2023.
Oh my gosh, I didn't get here. A little disclaimer.
Then 2022 Colorado pickups. Not available with some other offers. Take no retail delivery by 1-3-23.
This is your personal music history. 95.1 and 94.9. The Wow Factor.
Complete with some constant breaks for dead air. I can't believe a glitch like this has been going on for this long. Like, literally nobody that works at the station has listened to this station in the middle of the day. That's just... That's absolutely mind-blowing.
Give you my surprise.
All right, bust up on the right. Looks like it's functioning as a little homeless shelter right now. Well, there's quite the encampment going on right there, too, in front of Aspen Dental. Got themselves a little tent or something like that shut up.
I've been waiting so long to be.
Ooh, that trailer just passed me on the right has a flat tire. It's like the right front trailer tire is flat. I wonder if he's even aware of it.
The light shining through on you. Yes,
says the guy that drove about a mile from work on a flat tire.
It's the morning, just we two. I'm still now.
I'm thinking about how I handle that tire, and I gotta give props to Discount Tire for after I didn't show up for my appointment and didn't contact them for over a week for actually taking the initiative to call me and completely handling it. When I said I would show up in 30 minutes and showed up in 2 hours. Although the one tire covered by warranty, I mean, there was a little bit of a payment involved, but which was pretty much due to the fact that they couldn't repair it because I did sidewall damage by driving a mile on it with it totally flat. But, yeah, the one they replaced, like, I want to say it was about 50% worn. Had I not destroyed the one opposite it, I would have continued to drive on that for quite a bit of time afterwards. And it just occurred to me today that I probably paid, not only replaced a tire that was still serviceable. Now, of course, I fully support always, when I have the funds to do it, I always replace tires and pairs. It's not good to have a left and a right tire in a vehicle with uneven wear. But, you know, in the same front or back. But But yeah, I probably paid for disposal of a still perfectly decent tire, and it really occurred to me that I probably should have asked to be able to keep that and just have them put the empty tire in my trunk, or the unmounted tire in my trunk. And in case you're curious why, it's like, why would you do that? Well, A, I could have saved the disposal fee. Of course, then I'd be hoarding a tire, but I keep a full-size spare, and eventually there's going to come a time where that full-size spare is just, it's probably going to age out because of the dryness of the climate here before the tread gets worn off of it. Whereas the other one, very likely I could have kept it in my storage, and it would still be good, and I could have probably paid it, you know, three or like 10 or 20 bucks to mount it on the rim. But, oh well, missed opportunities. Definitely think of that the next time. Oh, I love this song, and it's about to have some dead air. Heard somebody sing it as karaoke. Probably about 6-7 months ago. And they changed one word, and I quite enjoyed it. Would it turn out right? Oh, I used to know all the words of that. I love the Little River Band. I can't believe the station is still messing up like that. What's up? What? I gotta get my rent. Say hi to them. Love those guys. And I'm back. It's still Thursday, the 29th, and 11:37 a.m. The Wow Factor, 94.9 FM, still having their issue with the music or whatever they're playing. It's happening to ads too. Cuts out and has breaks of dead air constantly. Which really sucks when they're playing songs that are this good. And I probably better keep talking, because if there's a content match on this song, it's probably going to block it. Of course, I don't have to worry about content blocks on periods of dead air from the Wow Factor. So I remember this is one of the first 45s I ever got of my own as a kid. And just to clarify that as got on my own versus got, the majority of the 45s that I had as a kid were hand-me-downs from my mother. I got some from some other family, but the bulk of them were from my mother. But that particular one, Give Me Love by George Harrison, that came out when I was a little kid, and absolutely loved hearing the song on the radio. And I used to take regular trips to the record store with my grandmother to pick out a 45, and that was one of the ones that I picked out. I was probably like 3 or 4 years old. So, yeah, I'm not even sure if I still have a copy of that 45 anymore. That, of course, That 45, the one I got as a little kid, would have been lost in my divorce with everything else. But I'm pretty sure I have that George Harrison album on vinyl now. Of course, as a little kid, I didn't really have albums. It was just all about 45s for me. Yeah, I did mention this station plays some 80s music. So here we go, Glenn Frey. I want to say this came out in like 86-ish, 85. And more dead air. This is the only member of the Eagles that I ever actually got to see live. Which isn't to say he's my favorite. He's probably my, if I'm honest, my third favorite Eagle after Glenn Frey and Joe Walsh. There was a time it would have been after Joe Walsh and then Glenn Frey, but the End of the Innocents album by End of the Innocents album by Don Henley is just so good, beginning to end. Kind of moved him up several notches for me a long, long time ago. Prior to that, I was much, much more into Joe Walsh. I still love all of Joe Walsh's solo stuff. And for that matter, as much as I'm really not into the Eagles, I really love Eagles songs where Joe Walsh is singing lead. On most of those, he was the primary songwriter. And to me, those don't sound like Eagles songs. Those sound like Joe Walsh songs. But yeah, this particular show, when I saw Glenn Frey, I forget what year it was. I'll say early 90s, mid 90s. Fun show, but I got free tickets for that. I don't remember exactly how I got free tickets. I used to get so many free tickets back in the 1990s. Even though I wasn't in radio broadcasting anymore, I still had a lot of connections in radio. And I just got hooked up a lot with free comp tickets.
All the music you love.
95.1 and 94.9.
The wow factor.
And when asked if I wanted free tickets to Glenn Frey, obviously the answer was yes. Sorry, I just noticed the little park there where I was turning left across the street. A little sliver of a park in the city of Phoenix is trying to sell its commercial real estate. It looks like it has more campers in it now than it did the last time I went by it. Curious if our new Arizona state governor that takes office in a few days is going to do anything to address the homeless issue. Which reminds me, I still haven't looked up to see what the heck's going on with that lawsuit that's coming from the Civil Liberties Union on behalf of homeless people in Phoenix. To be fair, I support the city of Phoenix cleaning up the encampments, but I don't support them not giving those people adequate time to pick up their stuff and just disposing of their stuff. Yeah, I think it's a lot more humane the way, not like California is a prime example of anything, but it's just one that I can think of that I've experienced firsthand and gone and witnessed in person, where they were putting written notices in places where you absolutely could not miss them. Along Venice Beach, and letting them know exactly what time the cleanup would commence and exactly where the cleanup would be, and then coming in and giving people reasonable amounts of time And reasonable is such a subjective term, but if what they were saying this morning on the radio is true, and I forget what amount of time it was, but yeah, if they're just giving them, you know, 5 minutes, get all your shit out of here in 5 minutes, or we'll throw it away, and they didn't, you know, give them any kind of notice that was going to be happening, yeah, that's not reasonable. It just isn't. Now, should all that stuff be there, and should they be squatting there? Oh, no, definitely not. But regardless, there's a fine line, and it does sound like the city of Phoenix is crossing it right now. That said, I think they should put those notices up at that park there at 40th and McDowell and give those people 48 hours to get the shit out of there. Although the fact that it's listed as being for sale through a real estate agent, there is a slight chance it's not a private owner at this point. Although the last I checked, it still had like several City of Phoenix signs on it, like on the property. So I don't know. Anyway, I'm just about to my landlord, so I should probably cut this out. But I'm going to keep updating these videos and see how long this issue goes on with the wow factor. And I am back. It is 11:52 a.m., way past my bedtime. But hey, rent is paid. Internet is paid. A pretty sizable load of recycling I want to drop off. And I was going to head out and get some cash to my mechanic. And Saturn just started making kind of a... Oh, look at that! Oh, and it's going the other direction! Oh, man! I was hoping it was going to follow me so I could pull over and pull the camera out and get a good view of it. That's the first one I've seen, at least that I've noticed, one of the new Amazon electric trucks. That was really cool looking. Car just started making a kind of not so good sound. Not like scared to drive it, but I'm thinking I should probably pop the hood, take a good close look at what's going on, and then head to the mechanics. But let's check the wow factor real quick. I don't believe it that you're in love. Dead air. Nope. Still not fixed. This bug has been going on for a while. I can't remember what time it started, but it should really be fixed by now. Just can't imagine a broadcaster absolutely not listening to their station in a market this big. Blows my mind. Alright, it is 12:08 p.m. I bought the last two quarts of oil that they had at Circle K. It was definitely lower than it should have been. And it's still a little lower than it should be, but, the wow factor is still having their constant little chunks of dead air. Playing one of my favorite songs of all time right now, too. From one of my favorite albums of all time, Nights in White Satin from Days of Future Past by the Moody Blues. Just recently scored another copy of that as a donation from someone. In the case of cassettes that Kimmy, the karaoke host over at the Wander Inn, gave me. Looked like an early to mid 80s cassette reissue of it, and played it all the way through a couple times. Sounds really, really good for a cassette that was made all those many years ago. And of course, I should be trying a little more to listen to the sound of my car. I listened to it idling with the hood popped. I'm not 100% sure what the issue is. Seems to be driving great. I'm crossing my fingers it's nothing to do with the engine, because that would suck. But kind of sounds like the bearing on one of the accessories on the motor, like the AC compressor or the or could be the clutch on the AC compressor. Kind of sounds like possibly that.
Breathe deep.
I love this part. I can't believe they're playing the poem on the radio. That's awesome.
Lights fade from every room. Bedsitter people look back and lament. Another day's useless energy spent. Impassioned lovers wrestle as one. Lonely man cries for love and has none. New mother picks up and settles her son. Senior citizens wish they were young.
Cold-hearted orb rules the night, removes the colors from our sight.
Our sight. Red is gray and yellow and white. But we decide which is right and which is an illusion.
You know, it seems like recently somewhere I saw somebody that had the karaoke version for that song that had that whole instrumental outro right up to the bong at the end, or the gong at the end. A bong is something completely different. Didn't have the poem, and it didn't have the text on the screen for the poem. But it seemed like it had all the instrumental there, so if you had the poem written down or you could absolutely remember it and recite it from memory, it was an option. And I should have really paid attention to what that was and where that was, because I still use the DK karaoke for Moody Blues, Nights in White Satin. And it's based on the single version of the song, which isn't lacking, but it doesn't have that part. And honestly, I'm really happy with the version, the DK version. Like, it sounds just exactly, you know, pretty much exactly like the song. When I sing that one, I feel like I'm really in the zone and bringing it. And I know I've sang the karaoke version through the Carafun streaming app over at Ozbar. And that version's really good as well, but if memory serves, it's same kind of thing. It doesn't have the very beginning, and it doesn't have that extended ending either. But I know there's a version out there that has it. I feel like I need it as an alternate version in my karaoke setup. Yeah, I can't really hear that sound right now. I can't hear it over the road noise. Oh, there goes the SkyTrain right above me. Can't really hear it over the road noise right now, even when I turn my radio down. But on the bright side, I was headed to Rob's anyway to bring him some cash. It probably should call first, especially with questions of sounds coming out of my car, but I would expect he would be there right now. I mean, maybe he's taking time off for Christmas, but I expect him to be there. Guess I'm gonna find out in a couple minutes. Still absolutely bewildered that this is going on with the wow factor. So I'm cutting out.
The wow factor is qualifying you for a chance to win a great Vegas getaway to see Frankie Valli and the Four Seasons.
That would be awesome.
At the International Theater at Westgate Las Vegas Resort and Casino. Including a two-night stay at Westgate Vegas. Listen for us to let you know when to text Frankie to 6.
Wait, no, what do? Leave me hanging. Ah!
Your Valley Chevy Red Tag sales event going on now. CSAN Chevrolet Glendale. New vehicles arriving.
I was really curious if that promo they were playing for their Frankie Valli and the Four Seasons giveaway would have a snippet of Beggin' in it. Which was only kind of a minor hit for Frankie Valli, but it's just been a big smash sleeper hit for Måneskin. And since that has happened, it's been one of my go-tos when I'm on the TouchTune, at a bar with TouchTune jukeboxes. Because it kind of brings a lot of different generations of music lovers together when it comes on. But probably wouldn't be as familiar to the average listener of this station.
You could avoid this by getting 65% off under Living Trust.
And of course, I didn't hear what to do to win the contest when it cut off. Oh, ain't that some shit. All right, well, I'm just about to rob shop, so I'm going to cut this off for a little bit. And hopefully this isn't a big deal. Let's get his... him see if he can figure out what this weird noise is and get him some cash, because God knows I still owe money for the motor in this thing. And I'm back, YouTube. This is such an awful driveway to get out of backwards. And look, he's got an oversized, ugly pickup for sale. Yeah, I don't want that at all. Yeah. And here comes one passing me on the left. At least that's a work truck. So, my guess of what it was right. I was thinking it was a bearing on something that was driven by the motor, and it is. It's the bearing in my alternator going out, so not a big deal. Not a big deal, but obviously something I need to get fixed. Said he's going to get it done tomorrow morning, so that's a good thing. But in the meantime, everything else is just fine. Let's turn up the radio. Oh, nice. Richie Valens, La Bamba. He's getting ready for it to cut out any moment now.
All the music you love.
I love this.
95.1 and 94.9.
The Wow Factor.
And there's the silence. I knew it was coming. Oh. Well, next stop. I'm so past my bedtime, by the way. Oh, I like this song too. This, you know, this is not the kind of music that I listen to the most, just to be completely clear. But the ratio of songs that I really, really like versus songs that I'm burnt out on and not interested in is really good on this station. If only they weren't delivered today with so much big chunks of dead air. Bugging me, I can't remember who the artist is on this song. So mind blown that a major market station can be delivering just a non-stop dysfunctional broadcast. I wonder when all is said and done, like how much they're gonna owe their advertisers credit for unplayed ads that were cut off and not played in their entirety. I think it's kind of neat on the right there how they store the extra sky trains on the on that extra chunk of rail up in the air. Thank you. every single note and word of this song, and damned if I can remember who sings it. So anyways, I was saying, next stop is my storage. Got a big bag of recycling from Priscilla that needs to go in there, a big box of recycling from my place, and there's a whole bunch in the car that I'd like to remove from the car. And now's as good of a time as any to get all my karaoke equipment that I've been storing at Bullock's that is not currently in my apartment into storage. Yeah, not looking to actively pursue any karaoke gigs anytime soon, other than I really do need to soon swing by and see what the status is of the ownership change over at Bullock's Cocktails. But I've pretty much decided I'm not willing to do a night of karaoke for anything less than $200 right now. And yeah, that's asking quite a bit, but it just doesn't make sense to me anymore to do a night of karaoke for significantly less than I make on an overtime shift at Amazon. Especially considering how enjoyable my job is at Amazon now, doing dominantly forklift and TDR. And hopefully we'll be doing safety as well. I don't think I even mentioned that today. So while I took Priscilla to her medical appointment, and while she was doing her, I don't know if it was a doctor. She tells me so much about her medical stuff, and it just makes my head hurt, because it's not like I don't want to be supportive. I'm a DJ, not a doctor. And, I'm glad she keeps a good firm handle on it. I'm not even good at keeping up on my own medical stuff, so. Another great song, Cut Out My Dead Air. Probably my favorite Doobie Brothers song. I can't think of one I like better than this. Just something about that whole vocal breakdown with the multiple harmony and round at the end of the song just makes it for me. It's a real fun one to sing for karaoke too, but there's so many different versions of it, and I never know exactly what version I'm going to get when I sing it at somebody's karaoke show. So when it hits the point where there's all those different harmonies and stuff, it's really kind of tricky to figure out, okay, what part is most lacking that I should do myself to blend in with what's here. It's always a challenging song to sing, always a super fun song to sing, and no matter what, I always seem to knock that one out of the park, so. Ain't got no worries. Oh my goodness. Vista Village is completely fenced off. And there's a sign saying it's some kind of shelter now, which makes me really wonder what happened to all the people that were living there, including my friend who was borrowing my DVD player. I mean, I'm not worried about the DVD player. I already got that back from her. I'm kind of worried about her. Supposed to get her a Blu-ray player, and I totally dropped the ball on that like ages ago, just because I got so overwhelmed for the longest time. Here's the breakdown. Pretty mama, come and take me by the hand, take me by the hand. Pretty mama, dance with your daddy all night long. I want to hear some funky Dixieland. Pretty mama, come and take me by the hand, take me by the hand. Pretty mama, with you all night long. I like to hear some funky Dixieland. Pretty mama, come and take me by the hand. come on, baby. Absolutely convinced I got that at home on a good functioning 8-track. I've got damn near the entire Doobie Brothers discography on 8-track, and it's awesome. Anyway, I'll be back with more. As long as I'm driving and running errands, I'm gonna keep on the station and see how long they can continue to broadcast this constant dead air. In
3 minutes or less.
And some dead
imagine
air.
Imagine your loved ones losing you unexpectedly. Now,
ooh, that
imagine
would be bad. And welcome back, you two. Oh yeah. The Wow Factor is still broadcasting constant chunks of dead air. 1:03 p.m. It is way past my bedtime. I think I'm not working tonight. It's getting awfully close to time to get up. Oh, I heard just a tiny bit of a good Frankie Valli song starting. Oh, it's back. I do want to kind of look in their website and see how to go about entering the contest to win their trip to Vegas to see Frankie Valli. Because I would love to do that. And maybe, just maybe, it's possible to enter through their website. Assuming they have a website. Oh my goodness. Elderly woman trying to cross the road with a cane and impatient pickup truck trying to mow her down. It's kind of sad. It's just sad all the way around. Trying to get to, but I hope she makes it. Yeah, Vista Village, 3541 East Van Buren Hall. La Casa Construction, and the entire building is fenced off. I saw La Casa, and I was thinking it was probably some kind of shelter, but some construction companies dealing with that property, which makes me really wonder where everybody that was there went. Finally got all my got all the karaoke equipment that I had in the packed in the car, pulled out of here. Not like it was much, but it was more than needed to be in here. a full week and a half since I did my last gig. My last gig was
still a bit longer than that. Last gig was
not last Saturday night, but the Saturday night before. So I did keep one of my books, and I use the term book kind of loosely because my books are not a traditional karaoke book. It only has one page that tells you that the list is online. So, I figure that's something I should have in the car just in case the time arises where somebody is interested and, oh, hey, I heard you host karaoke. You got any information? And I can give them, I still got the front pages, which, interestingly enough, I never did put Bullocks on it. I never did put Bullocks on the cover because I was never doing more than one night a week at Bullocks. And, Stones. Nice. Coming up on that little park. See how many people are camping in it. Meanwhile, more luxury condos going in on the right. And I still haven't figured out what the heck it is going in on the left, but it looks like it's going to be absolutely huge. I was front page on it. I forget what all it says on it. It's been so long since I've really looked at it. Pretty fancy tent right there. One tent. Two, three, four, yeah, more tents than I can count as I go by. And a vehicle parked on the left with its hood popped up. And some kind of freaky structure of charger was plugged in.
What the hell is that?
Yeah, Phoenix really needs to do something about all this. It's freaking ridiculous. Still got dead air on the Wow Factor, ruining a really good Stones song. It's a fun karaoke song too that I haven't had anybody sing in ages. It's been so long since choking on a taquito, I need to get some more food in before I knock out. Thursday, Del Taco has some kind of really good deal for 3 soft tacos. I know 6 of them will fill me up, so. Well, pretty new Escalade right there. Taco do not enter sign is completely upside down. Wonder what's up with that. Dollar drinks, medium iced tea, and coffee. We're good to see they brought some dollar drinks back. I wonder how many other people quit buying the strawberry lemonade and iced coffee when they jumped the price up something like 60%. Forget how much they raised it. It used to be 99 cents. It's a whole lot more now. We got the tamales. Hi, do you guys have tamales today?
Yes.
Can I get 2 of those? And then do you have the deal on the chicken soft tacos?
Yes.
How much is that?
3 for $2.92.
3 for $2.92. Yeah, I'll get that too.
Okay.
And that'll be it for me. Thank you. $1.69. That's what they raised the price on their strawberry lemonade to. $1.69 when for years it was 99 cents. That's just too much of a price increase for me. I'm out.
$8.35.
How's it going?
Good.
Oh shit, I'm gonna have to give you a card.
Any sauce?
No thanks. I wonder if she'll give me sauce anyway. There's been a lot of that going on with fast food lately. Recent trip to Del Taco and a recent trip to Taco Bell. Both asked if I wanted sauce. Hope I said no.
There you go.
Is my receipt in the back?
Yes, it is.
Awesome. Thank you. Yeah, both of them. And both of them gave me a ridiculous amount of sauce packets in my bag. And I think I consolidated them into one bag, and they're in my Amazon bag. I really need to clean up my Amazon bag between now and my next shift. It's just ridiculous how much crap I have. Oh, so I was going to say, before I got sidetracked by dead air on the radio, Well, Priscilla was at her appointment, medical appointment, whatever the hell it was. I shouldn't discount it like that. I should maybe pay more attention to what those things are, but it just... 90% of the time, I just really don't understand, like, when she explains what's going on. And, but I got her there and got her there in really good time and waited there with her for her to come out. And while I was there, made the most of my time while she was filling out intake paperwork. Todd Rundgren. Nice. I think I have an obscenely rare 8-track of the album that has this song on it. And not that the 8-track with the album with the song on it is rare, because that was a smash hit at a time when 8-tracks were a popular format, but the one I have is a misprint, wherein they put the stereo tape and label into a quadraphonic 8-track shell. So consequently, I can't play it on my quad player. My quad player will switch into quad mode, which ends up putting one of the stereo programs in the front speakers and one of the other stereo programs in the back speakers. Gotta play it on a stereo player that doesn't check for that. That doesn't check for that, the notch that's in the case. It differentiates a quad 8 from a stereo 8. Anyway, so at Priscilla's appointment, while she was filling out her paperwork, I was like, you know what, I should go to my car and grab some paperwork I'm supposed to be filling out. And I finally filled it out. Yes, there it is. I probably wrote way more than I should have. I probably could have put just minimalistic, what they want to hear, 5-word answers for each question. And honestly, I think I'm a shoo-in on this, regardless of what I put in the answers, unless I put just absolutely ridiculously bad stuff in it. Because, as I mentioned, one of the main guys in safety keeps asking me to be on the ASC, which I think stands for Amazon Safety Committee, which basically I do extra tasks for the safety team. As I mentioned before, when I was first asked to do it, which was probably when I'd only been there about 2 months or so, like it was in the 2 to 3 mark, more or less, the thought of being part of the, in any shape, way, or form, part of the Amazon Safety Police, it just didn't seem right. But at this point, I figure I've gained enough respect from different people in different parts of the warehouse, and I've just worked in so many areas that I think it'd be a good thing for me at this point. And please stop. Thank you. The guy did not look like he was going to stop coming out there. Anyway, every time I see that guy from safety, he mentions it to me, and I'm like, oh yeah, I've started the application, I'm gonna get it finished. I finally got it. It's so crumply looking. I'm gonna turn into my main manager, Dustin, and just ask him, hey, you think it'll be a problem that's a little bit crumpled up, or you know, it's legible. I'm kind of known for things that are well-worn, so it makes sense that my application for ASC would look well-worn. But I never really paid attention to the way this form is laid out. I mean, there's one-size questions that I'm supposed to fill out, as well as just, you know, information as far as name, login, shift schedule. Because there's like a shorthand for, you know, what your regular shift schedule is. And then also current department position, which of course looks a little sloppier now because I had to add TDR to it. But yeah, I used more space in my answers than I was probably supposed to, which makes it look really bad. But I figure I give it some good content. But I actually finally looked at the backside that my manager's supposed to fill out, and there's interesting kind of place where he's supposed to score me, which makes me wonder: would
We want you to be happy, and that starts with...
Would Dustin just score me really good? Or would Dustin sort me? Or would he rate me really honestly? Because there's one in here where you're rated on a scale of 1 to 4, and it very specifically states, you know, one being the lowest score, 4 being the highest score, and it very specifically states what the judgment is for each of those in each category. And the one means below expectations in current role, 2 means progressing to expectations in current role, 5 meets expectation in current role, and 4 means top performer. Now, I'm one that takes the literal word of everything very, very solid. And as I get down to one of them, where I would honestly have to be rated as progressing to expectation in current role, at least that's what the explanation of 2 is supposed to be, by definition of what is progressing to expectations in current role, as it's written here, and what would be the next 2 things of meets expectations, current role, and top performer, absolutely, I could never... If he answers it honestly and something that's verifiable, I could never progress beyond progressing to expectations. Does that mean because I made a mistake once, a documented mistake once, actually 3 documented mistakes, that I can never progress beyond progressing to expectations? Because I generally feel like with most everybody that I'm working with, and most management looks at me as somewhere between meets expectations and a top performer. But on this one particular one, the scoring criteria is listed as exhibits good safety-related disciplinary and safety history. I mean, obviously, I can change how I exhibit good safety-related disciplinary actions. And I still contend that I've always been pretty solid on that. However, safety history... History is history. There's no changing history. Contrary to what some people are trying to do, but that's a separate tragedy. Anyway, for me to score as 3, which is meets expectations in current role, the description is has no history of safety rule violations, while also no history of safety improvement activity. Well, I certainly have a history of safety improvement activity. It's been a long time since I've had a pit incident, but I do have 2 recorded. And I don't feel I really violated any safety rules per se, but I do have 2 recorded pit incidents that's resulted in me being suspended as a forklift driver. And I also have the robot incident, which is kind of ridiculous, and I certainly explained that in depth in a previous vlog. But, that's history, and I can't change that, and I will always have that history. So I can never progress to has no history. And then the next one, top performer, starts with the same 3 words, has no history. I can't erase history. It is history. It will always be my history at Amazon. Has no history of safety violations, and has participated in 1 or more safety improvement activities, i.e. safety circles. I'm not entirely sure what constitutes a safety improvement activity, but I feel like I've participated in many things that could be construed as safety improvement activities. But yeah, at this point, I think just because of those words has no history, and I can't change history, I can't change it to where I never stepped into a robotic palletizer cage. I can't make that not have happened. I didn't get fired for it, which is kind of an amazing thing. Like, that's something most people are instantly terminated for, so that's something. But I can't, it's still history. It still happened. So the next one down, which would only score as 2, as progressing 2, but obviously I can't be progressing because of the way it's worded. I can't be beyond this. The wording on that is, has experienced 1 or more safety rule violations, but is performing to expectations of corrective action.
That to a T describes where I am. But if Dustin answers that honestly, it'd be two. Yeah, one would not be me at all. That one says, has experienced one or more safety rule violations without completion of corrective or follow-up actions. Yeah, there's all three of those things are followed up on, and two of them required retraining for forklifts. So, yeah, that's not me at all. But yeah, I mean, number two, which is progressing to expectations, is... if we're going by the letter of what is written, would be me. Which makes me worry that Dustin, who's generally speaking absolutely static with my performance in Outbound, would go, oh yeah, five. Would go, oh yeah, four, he's a top performer. But then he's signing off on has no history. And pretty common knowledge in that building that I do have some history. All the rest of them, there's one, two, three, four, five other scoring criteria, and all of those I'm objectively a three or four in. Yeah, I can't change history, and as long as history is part of the scoring criteria, I will never be in. Anyway, so I'm wondering how it's going to do. It does say on here, for manager use only, and then it says the assessment process is to be used only if the number of associate volunteers exceeds the number of openings on the committee. This side is then to be completed by manager and turned into ASC chair. I'm reasonably sure Brian is the chair, the guy who's been kind of on me to do it. So, like I said, I'm pretty sure I'm a shoo-in on ASC. I guess I'm just bothered by has no history being a criteria, because that to me implies that once you've fucked up, you can never return from that, because you always have history. And that's something that I've faced as a convicted felon for most of my adult life. So when I see that kind of stuff, just how am I supposed to progress if progressing includes having no history? Anyway, there is a freeform place for him to write strengths and opportunities, and I'm kind of eager to see. Although I give this to Dustin, and then Dustin gives it to safety, so I may never see, you know, where it what he writes, but. Anyway, I'm eager to give that to Dustin on Sunday night, and I'm glad I finally had somewhere to sit down and have nothing else to do while Priscilla was doing her appointment and got that done. So, anyway, quick check of the radio. We're still getting dead air. Willpower, da da da, da da da. Getting who this artist is, but I really do like just about every song they play on the station. This is just all the oldies that I really, really like. Anyway, nope, they haven't fixed it. And I'm wrapping this up at 1:26 p.m., so that's several hours of, wow, y'all don't pay attention to your broadcast. That's absolute craziness to me. Anyway, thanks for watching, and be back with more of these stupid videos, so, you know, subscribe if you ain't done that yet.